oh boy, this led into our main event of the evening.
It was, and we talked about this in the last episode, that we were most looking forward to this fight, and Tabor, it lived up to the hypes.
Oh, absolutely. Edson Barboza, Dan Ige. First things first, we got to talk about how Edson Barboza looked on that scale.
Absolutely, and the way he cut weight.
Such a professional.
Yeah.
Such a professional. I don't know who he worked with, but oh my God, he looked great. He looked in fantastic shape. The man was still huge. He was still jacked. He was still the biggest 145er I've ever seen. I don't know how much weight he was cutting. Probably a lot.
Probably 15, maybe 30 20 pounds.
Yeah. 30 pounds, maybe. Who knows? I'm just going to guess a lot. He's the biggest 145er I've ever seen. But he made it perfect. 145.5. He probably could have made championship weight if he really wanted to.
If he really wanted to,
point?
Yeah.
What's the point? You get that pound allowance. So great job by him because he didn't look that bad.
I thought he looked incredible. And Dan Ige was hitting him with big shots too. And his chin held up.
Oh, in the fight, he looked incredible.
Yeah, for sure.
On the scale, he did not look bad. I expected him to look like death itself. Like,
he must be getting
the
same nutritionist that Jose Aldo is getting.
Yeah, that's somebody.
I mean, they're both out of Brazil, so it makes sense. I mean, maybe. Yeah,
well, Edson's training at American Top Team.
Yeah.
In Florida.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
So he didn't have to go far.
Yeah.
For this fight. That's really nice.
Yeah, he could have drove home. But boy, Edson Barboza. Another fucking razor thin close fight.
God, you gotta feel for this guy at some point. I feel like this dude is always in wars nonstop.
Yes. Against some of the best fighters in the world. I said this last episode.
Best fighters in the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Dan Ige is going to be a top five featherweight, I think.
For sure.
I think he's going to at least get a top five matchup. He deserves it after that win. Oh, you beat Edson Barboza at 145? Like, what? And you're a natural 145er? You're 5'7"? Yeah, you're jacked. Mm-hmm. And he's got great wrestling and all these stuff, blah, blah, blah. But, dude, you're going up against Edson Barboza. That man should be fighting at 170.
He probably should be. I mean, if he put on a little bit of weight, he could.
Yeah, honestly. Yeah. It's crazy. It's crazy the way this fight worked out. Dan Ige is so fucking tough. Oh my God. He was getting worked in that first round. Edson was hitting him with hard leg kicks. He's walking through them.
Those leg kicks were brutal. You could hear them.
Great boxing combinations. The body kicks. He even landed a spinning back kick, I believe. That first round was all Edson Barboza. Dan Ige was trying as hard as he can, but he's finding ways to land shots. But Edson was just so good and quick on the feet. And then in the second round, to come out and just turn it around like that for the first 4 minutes of the second round, it was all Dan Ige. He was beating his ass with those boxing combinations, landing huge punches.
It's normally Dan Ige's bad round.
Yeah.
Round two.
Exactly. And this time he got worked in the first. In the second round, he turned it around, was beating him on the feet. He was beating one of the greatest strikers we've ever seen in the sport on the feet. I was just shocked. I was like, oh my God. I was expecting him to take him down and grind him out.
And man, talking about that, credit to Edson Barboza's takedown defense.
Yes, because there was a few attempts.
Oh my God. The balance that he had on one particular where Ige is going for that single leg and he lifts it and he just yanks his foot out and keeps perfect balance. Mm-hmm. I was like, dude, that is a super athlete right there, because 99 out of 100 people fall over in that instance. And he was able to, like, catch himself and stay up. And it was so impressive. His takedown defense is brilliant. I mean, understandably why. Everyone's game plan against Edson Barboza is to take him to the ground.
Take him down, yeah.
You know, but...
And the only people to do that are Habib. Kevin Lee and Habib.
Yeah.
Like, it's those two. That's it. Mm-hmm. And
but Habib's able to do that to literally anyone on the face of the planet.
Yeah, it's insane. Insane. Do it to guys that's never happened to before. So, anyways... Dan Ige absolutely impressed me with the boxing, but then Edson, like, I don't know if he was a little bit gassed going into the second, but he really slowed down in the first 3 minutes of the second. But after about that, maybe that last 2 minutes, minute 30, he really started to pick things back up, landing more kicks, hit him with a body shot. There was at one time Edson hit a knee to the liver of Dan, almost dropped Dan with a knee to the liver. Dan had to back up instantly up against the fence, and he was hurt.
You knew he was in trouble.
He was hurt bad from that knee, and that was almost a turning point in the second where Dan kind of started losing it. Yeah. Edson started landing more kicks. Dan was still landing punches. But then at one point, I don't know if it was a failed takedown attempt, but then Dan decided to pull guard for the last 45 seconds of the second round. And then Edson just got on top and started pounding him almost.
Some very efficient ground game, too.
Probably, at least in the one judge that gave the fight to Edson, probably thought he won the round because of it. Mm. You know, you're on top of the guy at the end of the round, raining down shots. You're probably going to win.
Yeah.
You know, yep. At least the round.
So, well, maybe, depending on the judges, I mean, and the new scorecard. And that's kind of the one of the hot topics of this entire fight card for me. Because we had a great debate in the Walt Harris-Alistair Overeem fight in the first round. And it was the same thing in this fight, where it's like, who do you give that round to based on damage done and time spent, striking and doing that? I lost my train of thought.
You're probably saying that you probably have to give the round to the man who's on top, raining down shots when the bell rings.
Yeah, but I don't always agree with that.
Because it depends on the time.
Right, and I would have given Walt Harris that first round.
Okay.
Even though Alistair Overeem was on top the last part of that first round. I just thought he did more damage. I mean, you looked at Alistair Overeem and the combinations and knocking him on the ground. It's we'll talk about that fight later.
Well, who won the second round in your opinion in this Dan Ige Edson Barboza fight? Because I gave the first obviously to Edson. I felt like,
oh no, Ige won the second round.
I think yeah. So too.
Absolutely,
I think so too.
The 45 seconds wasn't enough for me.
Yeah, the third round was so fucking close.
It was.
That's the round where I'm like, I don't know.
Right.
I don't know. You could give it to either man. Dan Ige was fighting back as hard as he could, but Edson put it on that first 2 minutes in the third, and then. I think it was pretty back and forth for a minute and a half. And then like the last, what, minute? Dan Ige got that takedown, finally got him up against the fence and got that takedown. Nice, beautiful sweep. Took him down, pounded in, and stayed on top. I don't know, man.
Exactly.
I don't know because I feel like in that round, Edson Barboza was winning on the feet until essentially that takedown. For the last minute. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, yeah. So, in the last round, we gave it to Dan Ige. And then, essentially, the same thing happens for Edson. And
right. It's just, and that's kind of the so wonky thing difficult. About it. And not only that, that's fascinating to me, too. But that very last minute with Dan Ige, he did not land a bunch of significant strikes. He had control, obviously, on the ground. But it was a different scenario than Edson Barboza in that second round.
Yeah.
So, who do you give it to? That's why, for me in this fight, nothing was egregious. For me, it could have went either way because I had 1-1. Really I had 1-1 going into the third. Yeah. And the third was razor thin close. So, when I heard the decision, I was like, well, okay. I mean, either way.
Well,
that
I was happy.
Fight was just so good.
I was happy. I clapped. Yeah. I laughed. I didn't think Dan was going to win. I honestly thought Edson won that fight. And if I was a judge, I would have given Edson that third round. But... it would have been hard for me to give him that round. Either way, like you can't be mad at the judges on this fight,
no, you
honestly.
Can't.
Like
no.
I said earlier, there was some shitty judging. This one, I really can't be mad at them for this because it was so fucking close.
It was close, definitely.
And I feel like no one's stock goes down in this fight. No matter what, who won, who lost, no one's stock went down. Edson's still going to fight another top featherweight, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Dan will get his top five opponent, maybe top six, seven, eight, ten opponent. Who knows? We'll see. Who knows even wants who wants to fight? Everyone's just talking shit right now, and it feels like nobody wants to fight because there aren't any confirmed fights. So we'll see. But Edson, you know, how many fights in a row is this? Now is it by split decision? Two? Or is it three? No, he got knocked out by Justin Gaethje. So it's two split decisions. And he won that Paul Felder fight. Like, I love Paul Felder so much. I'm a huge fan of his, but let's be real. He won that Paul Felder fight. He really did. And he absolutely got robbed there. So I just feel for the man because he probably won this fight as well.
And question.
We'll see.
I'm just throwing this out here, right? You know, sometimes I like to do matchmaking.
Yeah.
What do you think about Cater? Cater versus Ige. Both of them just
Fuck,
coming off.
That's a great fight. He called out Cater. He said, I want to fight the Zabits. I want to fight them. I want to fight the Korean Zombies. I want to fight Brian Ortega. I want to fight Calvin Cater. I want to fight Jeremy Stevens. That's who he said. Right. He wants to fight any of those guys. He wants to get a top guy. He wants to fight that number one, number two guy. He wants a title shot.
Well, and I think Cater makes the most sense in the world. And I'll tell you why. Ige, 15. Cater, 7. Cater's just coming off the win. Ige's going to bump up. Mm-hmm. He's going to bump up. He has to. He beat Edson Barboza.
He'll be 12, 11, yeah. Maybe
so
top 10.
What a perfect fight.
Yeah.
Calvin Cater, Dan Ige. Let's do it.
I agree. That's an absolutely great match.
And they're both coming off wins. They're going to take some time, 5-6 months down the road, set that up, you know?
Yep. Fight Island.
Yep.
That's a great matchup. I'd love to see that fight. So Dan Ige is now on a 6-fight win streak in the featherweight division.
That's
he's
impressive.
Up there. He's up there because Alexander Volkanovski only has a 6-fight win streak, and he's the champion.
Yep.
Arnold Allen is on a 7-fight win streak in the featherweight division. It's the longest active win streak in the featherweight division.
Right, I love Arnold Allen.
Why not Dan Ige, Arnold Allen? Holy shit, that'd be a great fight. I don't know what Arnold Allen is even ranked, though. Is he barely even top 15? Who knows?
Yeah, Arnold Allen.
If he was top 5, oh, he's 12. That's, so that would actually be, he's not high enough.
Well, I know, but Ige's 15. But even with that, even with the Barboza win, I mean, maybe he gets 10.
Yeah.
You know, so that might not be a bad fight either. Arnold Allen versus Dan Ige. I like that.
Yeah.
I like that one, too.
When is Yair Rodriguez going to fight?
I kind of like the Cater one better. I got to be honest.
I like the Cater fight better. Because it's going to be a boxing matchup.
Exactly. You know it will be, for mm-hmm. sure. So.
And if Dan Ige thinks he could stand and trade with Calvin Cater, man, oh, boy. Oh, boy. I would be so impressed if he could. I mean, he just did it with Edson Barboza, so why the fuck couldn't,
why couldn't he
with,
do it
with Calvin Cater? Mm-hmm. So, oh, boy, that's a matchup I really want to see now. You're getting me hyped. You're getting me hyped. But I did. We didn't even go over our picks, did we? I took Marlon Vera, second round TKO, so no points. You took Song Yadong, unanimous decision, didn't you?
Yep.
So there you go. 3 points for you. I took Christoph Jocko, second round TKO, so it was unanimous decisions. I got 1 point there. You took Eric Anders,
KO, second round.
Yeah.
So none for me. And I had Barboza decision. And this is where, for me, it's like, if I would have had all those decisions, I could have caught up to you a little bit. I mean, at least make up a little bit of freaking ground.
Yeah.
I did not. Yeah. I just keep going farther and farther back every week.
Yeah, I took Dan Ige decision, so I got those 3 points. Yep. I predict these things.
I'm a fucking turtle.
Wrong one.
It's normal.
We got it.
There we go.
We'll remember next time.
We'll remember next time.
It's all good.